Chairman, for the introduction. I would like, first of all, to thank a lot the organizer of this very nice event in Frascati. And so I'm from the University of Camerino, in the Marche region of Italy, close to Ancona. And our university, with our condensed matter group, is also a member of the Multisuper network. And please take a look to the web portal for the next events of the superfluid of the Multisuper network for the next summer. So the content of my, first of all, I would like to thank the collaborators in this work. Among the years, I have collaborated with Pier Biagio Pieri and Giancarlo Strinati, who is here, on the BCS-BC crossover physics. And very recently in Camerino, we have started an experimental activity for the electrical characterization of superconducting nanostructure in collaboration with Nicola Pinto. Among the years, I have collaborated on the superstripes with Antonio Bianconi, Rick Masrom, and with Antonio Valletta, who is also here, CNR. And now we have a joint program of a PhD with Milorad Milosevic in the University of Antwerp, partially focused also on nanostripes and nanosuperconductors. I would like to thank all our PhD students, and in particular Vittorio Mazziotti will present a poster on new organic superconductors. So, first of all, I'm going to present an overview of the shape resonance scenario. I would like to focus the attention on the fact that quantum size effects and strong quantum confinement is able to introduce in the electronic band structure a system of subbands which is able to give you multi-component superconductivity and multi-gap condensates which are relevant for the present work I'm going to present today. Then a part of the talk will be dedicated to the superlattice of stripes, the superstripes, and which are the key prediction for the superconducting properties of the superstripes. First of all, the properties of the superconducting domes, the gap to TC ratios, and the anomalous isotope effects, which is really very characterizing. Then the final part of the general overview of my talk is the search for optimal configurations to reach a very high TC superconductivity. Hopefully, we will reach room temperature superconductivity in the near future. Let us see what will happen. It's a project. And the main part of this topic will be on the possibilities given by the multi-component BCS-BC crossover. So the BCS-BC crossover in a two-band electronic system in the presence of Lipschitz transition. Then, as a new example and new results, I will present a possible high TC superconductivity in K-doped paraterphenyl, which is an example of a striped multi-component metal organic system. And to deep this part, there will be the poster of Vittoria today and in the next days. So, first of all, I would like to recall that the superconducting shape resonance in the strong quantum confinement regime are characterized by two elements, which are single particle effects. So in the single particle effects, we have jumps in the density of states, and so we have that the multi-band structure will generate Van't Hoff singularities and Lipschitz transition, which are really very interesting for the superconducting properties. But then, the strong quantum confinement is not only limited to single particle effect, but also in the two-particle physics, which is very important. Because once you reach the dimensional crossover and you make a strong confinement of the wave function are strongly changed, and so the pairing interaction is strongly, you have a reconfiguration of the pairing, which is very important with respect to the bulk system. And so the pairing will acquire a subband dependence and also an interesting wave vector dependence. So altogether, single particle effects and two particle effects generated by strong quantum confinement will lead to very interesting many particle effects, and in particular shape resonance in the superconducting properties, which give rise to multi-gap states, gap and TC amplification with the interesting shape of the superconducting doves, anomalous isotope effect, and the BCS-BC crossover with the mixture of local and extended pairs. So BCS-BC crossover in, for instance, a two-band situation. The shape-resonant superconducting state is really non-uniform in space. So the starting simplest theoretical approach, which captures the essence of a strong non-uniform behavior of the condensate, is the Bogoliubov of the Gen theory, so the Bogoliubov of the Gen equation. But in the strong quantum confinement regime, it's possible to apply in a very nice way, in a very confident way, in a very satisfactory way, the Anderson approximation. So the Anderson approximation is a satisfactory way when you consider nanoscale system. So the nanostripes proposed have been proposed in 1996 and 1997, first of all in terms of single stripe, and then in the form of superlattice of stripes, together with Bianconi, Valletta, Saini, and Alessandra Lanzara. So these are the seminal works. So the consequence of strong quantum confinement, for instance, in the case of deep stripes, so with a quite high, the height of the barrier is considerable, you have the formation of a system of subband and interesting peaks in the density of states in the form of Van't Hoff singularities. In the case of shallow stripes, the Van't Hoff singularities are less pronounced, but still here, and this is very interesting because the consequence in the Fermi surface structure is the following. You start, for instance, in the first subband to have a quasi one-dimensional Fermi surface, then moving, for instance, the chemical potential toward the second subband, in the case of the superlattice, we are in the superlattice case, a second closed Fermi surface appear here, so you have a first Lissi transition. Then you continue to move the chemical potential, you pass the second Van't Hoff singularity here, and the system becomes again one-dimensional. So you have a two-dimensional, one-dimensional crossover when you open a neck in this second appearing Fermi surface here. So the most interesting Lissi transition we are considering in our scenario is the Lissi transition at the dimensional crossover. For instance, in this case, 2D, 1D crossover, two-dimensional, one-dimensional crossover. The system of equation which you get from the Anderson approximation to the Bogoliubov of the Gen equations are displayed here. So you have a multi-gap equation. For instance, t equals zero, this is a multi-gap equation, coupled to the density equation, which is very important in the case of the BCS-BC crossover, to have the coupling to the density equation. But you see here that the standard BCS approximation for the pairing, in which you have an energy cutoff omega naught plus a coupling, is strongly renormalized with the reconfiguration due to the quantum size effect and the new wave function, which you can get from the Schrödinger equation. And so your pairing interaction will acquire a subband and a wave vector dependence. So the main consequence of this superlattice of stripes in the superconducting properties is, of course, the first instance, the presence of a dome when you move or you tune the density or you tune the geometry of the stripes. You can tune by changing the width of the stripes, you can apply pressure or something like that. So the shape of the dome, of the superconducting dome in the gap and also in the critical temperature, is determined by the characteristic of your superlattice. So if your superlattice is shallow, you have a very wide dome with a very weak Van't Hoff singularity here. So the two-dimensional part will dominate, and then you have just a small one-dimensional part. And in total, the dome will be very huge, very wide, with a small amplification factor in the critical temperature. When you arrive to the optimal condition, when the bandwidth across the superlattice, So the bandwidth of the bands forming because of this of the periodicity of the stripes is of the order of the cutoff of the energy of the pairing. So omega naught is the typical energy scale for the repairing interaction. D is the bandwidth of the bands along a transversal to the stripes. When they are of the order 1, you have the optimal configuration with nice factor 4 of amplification, and the dome is quite large. And in this situation, you can have the hope that the superlattice of stripes is able to stabilize the superconductivity against strong low-dimensional fluctuation. In this other situation, the dome is very narrow. You have very good amplification factors, but you expect very strong and severe low-dimensional fluctuation. Another very interesting point I would like to focus here is that when you consider the dome, the superconducting dome, you have a typical shape anti-resonance and shape resonance situation, which is typical of the Fano resonance in atomic physics, of the Feshbach resonance in nuclear physics. And so, not only you have a very pronounced maximum, but also, I mean, when you are far away from the Lissy transition, you have the anti-resonance with a minimum in TC and with an amplification factor, a negative amplification factor. So this shape is very typical of the resonance behavior. Exactly in between, you have a two-band BCS-BC crossover behavior, which we are going to explore later, and also an anomalous isotope effect, which I'm going to discuss for the organic materials. Now, just to report a few experimental results around which are useful for this scenario. Here we have enhanced superconductivity accompanying a Lissy transition in electron-doped iron chalcogenide monolayer. So as a function of potassium doping, you see here you have four electron pockets, and then at a certain point for around 0.2 concentration of potassium, a new electron pocket appears at the center, at the gamma point here. And in this situation, there is a jump of 15 Kelvin in the TC, but also a jump in the gap. And so this is a situation which it is experimentally demonstrated that the amplification factor of the Lissy transition in an iron chalcogenide system, which is multi-band and multi-Fermi surface, multi-gap. Now, the story of the stripes is, since 1996, the attempts to realize superconducting stripes were really a few. But we have something. For instance, in the case of aluminum, we have the possibility to see these experimental results between 2004 and 2005. And in these experimental results, the diameter of the aluminum nanowires has been reduced till 10 nanometer, and you see that there is a nice amplification factor till 50%. And this is a fit of the, this is a boogie loop of the Chang calculation reproducing perfectly the situation. Of course, also in aluminum nanograins, you have amplification of this order. Then another interesting point is to go from a single nanowire or a single stripe to a pattern of stripe to see if you have some stabilization factor. We found an example on scientific reports of 2016 in which these authors observed dramatic enhancement of superconductivity in single crystalline nanowire arrays of tin. But as you see in the picture, they are coupled but randomly oriented. And in any case, this is leading to a signal in the specific heat, which is interesting around 5.5 Kelvin. And so, I mean, this is a nice situation, but still, we need to work on this. Regarding the BCS-BC crossover, so the main point of this talk is that the optimal configuration will be found when a BCS condensate, partial condensate, so weakly coupled, will coexist with a partial condensate in the BCS-BC crossover. So, this, at the mean field level, the most simple scheme we could use to start learning about the BCS-BC crossover in a two-band system is the one with parabolic bands and circular concentric Fermi surface. Several results and characterization of this crossover can be also can be found in the paper by Iskin and Sademelo, who is here, PhysiRevB 2006. We have done a paper with my ex-PhD student on this system in order to build boundary diagrams and to find a detection parameter for the crossover which could be simpler with respect to the pair correlation length to characterize the crossover. And after a study in the single band case, we found that the gap in the shallow band with respect to the local Fermi energy ratio, which can be measured by ARPES, can be a nice detection parameter for the BCS-BC crossover in multi-component systems. And so here there is the BCS boundary, the crossover boundary, but in the case where the gray line is a single band case, in the two band case, the presence of a weakly coupled band make a strong retardation effect to enter in the bosonic regime. So in the presence of a reservoir of charges, which gives to you a high stiffness, it's very hard for the system to enter in the bosonic regime. And so the two-band system, the most simple things that can happen is to be in the crossover regime and with several difficulties to enter in the bosonic regime. If you take the values of several iron-based materials, for instance, this one is iron chalcogenite, you see that the iron chalcogenite are or in the crossover regime or they are approaching slowly the bosonic regime without entering because it's far away. And so this is the first message that already at midfield level, the second band makes very difficult to enter in the crossover regime. Then we started to study also the superconducting fluctuation at the moment at a Gisbrough-Landau Popov approach, but so in the weakly coupled regime. And this is very interesting because the presence of two bands, one strongly coupled with pairs strongly coupled and the other with weakly coupled pairs, allows you to have the phenomenon of the screening of the superconducting fluctuation. So if you start from a system in which you have the two critical temperature of the two decoupled bands very close to each other, it's very difficult for the Gisbrough-Levenhuk number, which quantify the width of the superconducting fluctuation region, it's very difficult to the Gisbrough number to detach from this situation, and so the fluctuation will remain strong. And the renormalization of the critical temperature, giving to you very low values of the critical temperature, will remain severe. Instead, in the situation in which you have two uncoupled bands in the uncoupled situation with critical temperature very different each other, so one is weakly coupled and the other is strongly coupled, you have a wide region in temperature in which the Gisbrough-Levenhuk number can remain close to the one with the small Gisbrough number, with large stiffness. So the Gisbrough number controlling the amount of superconductive fluctuation behave like resistance in parallel. And so the one with larger stiffness, so the weakly coupled deep band, is the one most favorable to screen the severe superconducting fluctuation. And so the idea is that to search for two band configuration which are favorable for ITC superconductivity, you need to consider two bands crossed by a single Fermi chemical potential in which the coupling is unbalanced, very different coupling. And in this situation, you see that you generate this new phenomenon, which is the screening of the superconducting fluctuation thanks to the deep band, while you use the strong coupling of the shell of a flat band, like the shape resonance scenario, and you see what happened. That the pseudo gap region, this can be underdoped cuprates. The pseudo gap is very large. It's a very large region, and TC is very suppressed. While when you go in a situation of very unbalanced bands, you can have a strong screening. Pseudo gap region will be tiny, and the renormalized critical temperature, which is the blue one, is starting to approach the mean field critical temperature. So the message is that the screening of superconducting fluctuation permits to the mean field approach to be valid, to be robust. The screening of the deep band maintains the validity, if you want, of the BCS approach. And so is a route for ITC superconductivity. Now, where is the chairman? Just to know how many minutes I have?
5 minutes to go.
Okay, so here we can enter in one new example. Of course, as you know, last year there were several experimental attempts by the group of Cheng in Shanghai, reporting experimental measure by susceptibility and some preliminary resistivity measurements of superconductivity on a class of chain link molecular solids. So not only molecular solid, but also chain link. And so the class of organic material is the class of paraterphenyl doped by potassium. Paraterphenyl is an insulating system. When you dope with potassium, it becomes first metallic, and then lowering the temperature, superconductor. This is the system with three benzene rings, and this link, in my opinion, is very fundamental to give the freedom of rotation to the central ring and very high energy phonons, reaching 120 millielectron volt of phonons. And when you dope with the potassium, with the three potassium, you have again a crystalline phase, which is stable, and the crystal structure resemble very closely the one of a striped system, because the system is first of all layered, but not only layered, is organized in form of stairs and in form of quasi one-dimensional stripes. And if you see the lattice parameters, it is really very clear, and also is very clear from a numerical simulation by Balaski group of the band structure, because along the Brillouin zone, you can recognize different, several flat regions, highlighting the situation in which, in some direction, the transport is really very difficult. And so the system is really strongly anisotropic, and not only strongly anisotropic, so quasi one-dimensional, but also is multiband. Because you see, you have many bands crossing the Fermi level, you have some hole pockets, and you have some electron pockets. So the situation is such that is really very promising for a multi-super organic material. From the point of view of the density state, it's also very interesting, because you see that electron doping is very different from hole doping. Because when you do hole doping of this guy, it's true that it becomes metallic, but metallic with only flat bands. So completely hopeless to have high TC in this situation, because TC will scale, no? As, the superfluid density will be a bosonic system in this situation, very low TC. Instead here, the situation is promising because you have coexistence of shallow flat bands giving to you peaks of the Van't Hoff singularity peaks, which helps in strongly enhancing the already strong electron-phonon coupling, the already very high energetic electron-phonon couplings, together with other deep bands of 400 to 500 millielectron volt. And so in this situation, we have the coexistence of large, of deep and shallow bands, and the shallow bands, we have very high electron-phonon couplings, further enhanced by Van't Hoff singularities. And if confirmed, the first measurements by Cheng group display 120 Kelvin of superconductivity, while ARPES measurements of the gap at 60 Kelvin done by the Dessau group in Boulder, Colorado, reported gaps of the order of 20-30 millielectron volt. So very, very huge gap still at 60 Kelvin. So the system is very promising. And we build up our scenario based on shape resonance, quasi 1D configuration of stripes, and we predicted the superconducting dome, but also what is very interesting is the shape of the isotope effect. So we have a very anomalous isotope effect. So when the TC is low, because in this system you cannot control very well the potassium doping, so you have a distribution of cases, when the potassium doped is out of the optimal, TC is very low, and we predict a very large isotope effect also going above, well above the BCS value of 0.5, reaching 1.2, and then very low values when you reach 120 Kelvin of TC. We're also working in Camerino with our chemistry division and our physics division to synthesize these materials, having difficulties, but we are trying to go on. Now, conclusion. So, which can be the optimal configuration for very high TC superconductivity, hopefully one day room temperature, at least two bands in which Cooper pairs form, two gap superconductors. It can be also generated in effective way by quantum critical points, multilistic physics with stripe scenario, or selective MOT transition as many talks have shown during these days. One shallow band with a strong pairing, and so we have an onset of local pairs at a very high temperature and precursor pseudogap phenomena, and one deep white band with a weak pairing. This BCS-like condensate will provide the large stiffness to screen the detrimental superconducting fluctuation. Of course, these two subsystems need to be coupled, and at least a Cooper pair exchange, even small, better intermediate, is present between the two condensates. And so the BCS condensate plus BCS-BC crossover condensate, not bosonic, BCS-BC crossover condensate in the same two-gap superconducting system as ideal to stabilize room temperature, hopefully room temperature superconductivity. Thank you very much for your attention.